Ambassador John Bolton, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for joining us.
Glad to be with you.
So obviously, we're here to discuss the book, The Room Where It Happened. You have it behind you. Now it's in front of you. Great reading. Consumed my July 4th and the days after. But after reading it and then knowing about you and what you did in the administration, why did you not call it No Bad Deals on My Watch?
Well, that's a theme that I'd like to think people would come away believing that I spent a lot of time, as did the staff of the NSC, in damage control. What I wanted to convey was a certain sense of immediacy, and I hope that's what the title does. It's certainly gotten a lot of attention.
It has gotten a lot of attention, and one of the things you address at the very end of the book is the timing of the publication, and I thought you quite effectively answered that question by referencing something else you wrote back when Secretary Robert Gates published his memoir during the Obama second term. Just give us a couple of sentences on that piece you wrote and the rationale for publishing now.
Well, Gates came under intense criticism because he published his book during the term of the president he served. And also because many people said, gee, Hillary Clinton, your former colleague, is running for president. It's kind of inconvenient for her. And the point I make is these memoirs are always inconvenient for somebody. That's the whole point of them. But most Americans don't get a chance to be in the room where it happened. They don't really know what's going on. And I think not only is there no breach of confidence in writing a book like this, I think senior administrative figures have almost an obligation to write books like this. We're all adults. We're all big people. We all know that that something we say in a discussion could appear in the newspapers the next morning. I'm not afraid of that. I give my advice in a candid fashion. And as to why it's appearing in an election year, that's the way it breaks with the pre-publication review and the rest of it. But to say you should wait till after the president's out of office, as Donald Trump himself did, threatening to stop publication of the book before the election. If you can't give the American people evidence about a president's competence and character during a presidential campaign, when in God's name are you supposed to give it?
So obviously this timeline, release of the book, the reelection campaign, in your mind, seeing how it's all played out afterwards, do you think your memoir is actually impacting the way people vote? Or do you think people really, after 4 years of Donald Trump, know exactly what they're getting?
You know, it's very hard to say, but I will say this, as opposed to other books written by reporters and so on that are relying on secondhand information, the way I wrote the book was intended to convey to people really what it's like to be there when it happens. And if people read through it, they'll draw their own conclusion. But I think the reality of the conversation back and forth is much more accurate than the reporter's take on it through anonymous sources and the rest of it. And in any event, 50 years from now, when all the players are gone from the scene, the book will still be there.
Yeah, and it's 500 pages. It's actually dizzying at times, the back and forth. The president's mode of thinking certainly is dizzying, getting from Afghanistan to Syria to Africa to Europe to, you know, all in one conversation. It's hard to keep up with that. And of course, to give coherent advice is the challenge. During the impeachment proceedings, of course, you made yourself available to the Senate. They chose not to take you up on that offer. Would 20 pages of impeachment testimony done enough?
I don't think it would have made any difference, frankly. I just this past weekend was looking through some old papers, and I came across Lamar Alexander of Tennessee just about the time the Senate was going to vote on whether to have witnesses. He said, I accept that President Trump asked for a quid pro quo. I accept all that the Democrats are saying, but it does not rise to the level of an impeachable offense. And so I think whatever I would have said would have gotten swept away. I think the Democrats did this as a partisan effort. I think that's impeachment malpractice. That's not the way. There's no chance of succeeding. And I think their failed effort did not deter Donald Trump. I think it emboldened him, if he gets a second term, to do more of exactly what they were complaining about.
Yeah, you've been critical of the Democrats' impeachment effort, feeling that perhaps the Ukraine piece wasn't impeachable conduct, but there was a broader pattern which they choose not to pursue for a variety of reasons. And that you've suggested that if they would have looked at that broader pattern, there may have been some impeachable conduct there. Can you talk more about, quote unquote, the broader pattern you describe in your book?
Well, the president famously gets on very well with authoritarian leaders, Xi Jinping, Vladimir Putin, Erdogan of Turkey, Kim Jong-un of North Korea. And, you know, he's a big guy, he's dealing with the other big guys for whom due process is not exactly a high priority. And he had a propensity to say, well, Huawei, you know, it's true they're spying on us, trying to infiltrate our fifth generation telecommunication. But, you know, for you, I'll waive the penalties. Or the same sort of thing with ZTE, another China concern. This looseness with law enforcement, I think, was very troubling. I don't doubt the president's constitutional authority. It's not a question of authority. It's a question of judgment and motivation.
Right. So in terms of the constitutional authority to engage in foreign relations, there's an argument there that he can do this. Your concern was about the character and perhaps infatuation with authoritarians. Did you witness any warm, close relationship the president may have had with a democratically elected leader? I'm not going to put Erdogan in that category.
Right. Well, I think he had a good relationship, still does, with Prime Minister Abe of Japan. I think he does with Boris Johnson of the UK. I have to say, both Johnson and Abe worked very hard at it from their point of view, because the relationship with the U.S. is so important. I think a lot of our democratic allies tried that. Some had better success than others.
Yeah. Let's move now to present day challenges. Of course, the president has more than double digit kind of behind Joe Biden. Biden has that double digit lead. Coronavirus seems to be at the center of it. You, again, firsthand involvement in quote unquote decision making in the Trump administration. Anything surprise you about the way the coronavirus is being addressed by the Trump administration and by the president himself?
Well, unfortunately, no, because I think it's been demonstrated really going back to January, there's no strategic thinking involved in this response at all. The president is doing exactly what he did in national security issues. One morning, his gut tells him to do one thing. That afternoon, it's something else. By the end of the week, it's something else. Each day is a new day. You never know what's going to happen. And that's bad enough in the national security field, but you know, nobody gives memos to the virus about how it's supposed to respond. So you see bits and pieces of the federal government trying to do what they think they're supposed to do. You see the states and local governments trying to respond. Where's the grand strategy at the national level? It's just not there. And it hasn't been since the early days when he wasn't listening to people telling him this could be very serious. And you need to respond. He just talked about it not being a problem. And we lost several months where we could have taken significant action we didn't take.
One of the things the president highlights is that he was the first even really rejecting Dr. Fauci's advice to prevent travel from China into the United States. Do you think the coronavirus, COVID-19, has fundamentally altered the president's view towards China? You've said elsewhere, perhaps, that in a second term, the president could easily kind of shift away from the harder line he's taken towards China.
I still think that that shift is possible. Look, the evidence of China's covering up the source of the coronavirus, and maybe worse than that, I think is very strong. And I think the mood of the country, the mood of much of the West toward China has been changing over the past 10 years or so because of what they're doing in trade and South China Sea and East China Sea, a whole range of issues where Chinese behavior is seen increasingly as unacceptable. And what happened with the coronavirus, I think, was a triggering event that has quite likely caused a shift, perhaps bipartisan shift in American opinion, even beyond the scope of Tiananmen Square in 1989. So the president, you know, seeing his troops heading off in one direction, wanted to get out in front of him. But I'll guarantee you, and I'd bet at least a dollar on it, that the day after the election, if he wins, he's going to want to be on the phone with his buddy Xi Jinping saying, hey, now let's talk about the big trade deal.
And that's the great white whale.
Exactly. It is the great white whale for Trump. The deal of the century. Because once he's reelected, he will have no electoral constraint on him. He will think about his legacy, which is a word that always bothers me. And what direction he goes in, I think, is highly up in the air for debate.
So let's talk about that a bit. You know, one of the interesting things about your book is this kind of tension between good policy, but also letting Trump be Trump. You know, they say that about President Reagan, let Reagan be Reagan. And I think in some respects, you came in really trying to allow President Trump to be President Trump. Iran deal pulling out may be the best example. But I think over the course of the book, it appears to me that at times you had to function as, quote unquote, the adult in the room, perhaps language you wouldn't use, but that's the way it came across to me. Let me go down the list of policy areas, and you could just say in or out, right? We'll do the lightning round of what a second Trump administration would look like from a foreign policy and national security perspective. Afghanistan, we have the deal with the Taliban. Troops in or out in a second term?
Out, but this deal is going to fail. I think he'll still get out.
He will be out irrespective of whether the deal with the Taliban succeeds. Okay, great. NATO, does the United States remain in NATO?
I'm very, very much worried the answer is out there.
Out of NATO. Troops on the Korean Peninsula in South Korea?
Reduced, if present at all.
And then U.S. troops in Germany?
I think they will be largely gone from Germany, maybe elsewhere in Europe, I hope, but it's a pretty grim prospect, I think.
Right. So maybe in Poland, but perhaps back in Texas or wherever else the home base is.
Right.
And then we talked about China. What about Iraq?
Out.
Out of Iraq.
For sure. And out of Syria.
And then no doubt, I mean, you spent a lot of pages in the book talking about trying to maintain some level of presence in Syria, dealing with the challenges between ISIS, Iran, and then, of course, the Kurdish issue with the Turks. The president will just outsource that to who? Iran and Russia?
And Turkey and anybody else. He just has no concept of the strategic importance of that part of Syria.
So let's take a broader point here. I mean, the president then really has a Fortress America, isolationist outlook, and at least with respect to the U.S. presence overseas. I'd love to get your reaction to a question we asked in the Reagan National Defense Survey, an annual survey we conduct. This is months old, but still I think the data is pretty solid. The question was, Americans strongly support maintaining an overseas military presence? On average, 65% of Americans support maintaining bases because, again, it's not to go to war, it's to maintain the peace, including Democrats were 64%, Republicans 66%, and Independents 62%. How would President Trump react to that polling?
Well, I think he'd say it was fake news. I think he hears from people on the Hill who tell him his base wants to pull back to Fortress America. I would not say, though, he's got an isolationist philosophy. That would give him too much credit. It would assume he's capable of having a philosophy. I think these are knee-jerk reactions. One response he would give would be, I've dramatically increased the Pentagon's budget over the Obama years, which is true. But there's another question for you in the second term. Will he keep that budget at the levels it's at or increase it? And he just doesn't get the argument that a strong Reaganite defense sometimes requires forward deployment. Whether you like it or not, it often it helps defend America better, not the places we're basing people, but America itself by being overseas. I don't think he gets that argument.
Yeah, it's interesting. I've heard you say this, and you wrote in the book that the president doesn't have a governing philosophy. But it would seem to me that these views with respect to U.S. military presence overseas really is, kind of a strident, closely, kind of held or something that he believes in fundamentally, and felt that consistently his appointees, his advisors, the bureaucracy were working against him. If it's not a philosophy, what is it?
I think it's a series of ad hoc reactions. You know, he thinks the terrorists are thousands of miles away and can't threaten us again. He thinks Syria is somebody else's business. There are a series of discrete reasons. But yet he has not really fully acted on all of them because he understands the political argument and the reaction, the negative reaction he'd get in the Republican Party, and I think in the country as a whole. That's why I'm so worried about the second term, because he doesn't have to worry about a reelection prospect if he wins in November.
So before we talk about the second term and what happens if it's a Biden administration and get to your views on that, you did mention the president will have some of these instincts reinforced by members of Congress. Of course, Senator Rand Paul is probably the most outspoken of the members of Congress who are talking for, you know, this Fortress America and bringing everybody home. In a second term, what role do you think a Senator Rand Paul will play in a Trump administration?
Well, I worry that that it could be something in the cabinet. I mean, I think this is something very, very serious. And I don't think Republicans who I would consider in the Reagan tradition did enough in the first 4 years to come in and talk to the president over and over again. And just because they talk to him once doesn't mean it makes an impression. You have to keep coming back. I tried to get more of them into the Oval Office. Obviously, I'm not there to do it anymore. I hope on their own, they see the importance of being with the president as much as they can.
Yeah, I mean, you've spoken about this, that congressional critique at times really was what prevented the president from making a decision that you disagree with, be it Syria or Afghanistan or troops in Germany, for example. Do you see those senators, even if they were to follow the tack you've just articulated, repeatedly going at the president, trying to impress upon their views in a second term, would those matter, President Trump?
Well, I think this goes to a question that also relates to the upcoming election. Is for 3.5 years, a fair critique of many people, many Republicans in Congress, is that they didn't disagree with the president often enough. You know, nobody wants to be the subject of a Trump Twitter rant, a two minutes hate, as George Orwell would have called it. But, you know, they've got now their own election in November to think about. And again, they're going to be free from political constraint in a sense if there is a second term. So we're going to have a conversation about the future of conservatism. And I hope Ronald Reagan's place in it, whether Trump wins or loses in November.
So we're going to go to that in a second. But you've said publicly that while you'll not vote for President Trump in the upcoming election, you will also not vote for Joe Biden. National security, foreign policy, defense, of course, are your areas of focus and expertise. What about Joe Biden's outlook will prevent you from voting for him?
Well, I think at best with Biden, whom I've known for many years and in foreign affairs and on the Judiciary Committee, at best, a Joe Biden administration will be 4 more years of Barack Obama. And it was in reaction to that that I was prepared to support Trump over Hillary Clinton in 2016. I've just seen it in action now, and I can't in good conscience vote for him again. But that's not because I think Biden is preferable. It's an unhappy election for me, and I think for many conservatives. And what I fear even more about Biden is the left wing of the Democratic Party, which doesn't talk much about foreign policy because it's intent on a radical domestic agenda. But I very much fear what they will be saying to a President Biden if he's elected.
Let's talk about the future of conservatism. You've hit on it a couple of times. Let's just say, for argument's sake, that Joe Biden is elected president. There is no Trump second term. They're obviously a very divided kind of conservative movement. There's the kind of full-on MAGA pro-Trump side. There are the never-Trumpers on the other side, and there are a lot of people who straddle in the middle, people who perhaps liked many of President Trump's policies, at least as they played out in action, but at the same time had difficulty swallowing President Trump's character and felt that his kind of leadership style was something they couldn't sign up for. Do you believe there will continue to be a struggle on a policy level between kind of the MAGA agenda, whether it's foreign policy or domestic, and then kind of traditional perhaps what people dismiss as establishment conservative approach to foreign policy and domestic affairs?
Yeah, I think that's going to be a critical battle after the election, whether Trump wins or loses. I am optimistic that the Reagan approach will prevail, but it won't prevail as just we just sit by and watch it happen. I think that's one reason it's absolutely critical we keep a Republican majority in the Senate. We need it whether Trump wins or loses, but especially if he loses. And I think this debate is already beginning under the surface. It's kind of simmering. Whether it'll break out before the election or not, I don't know, but it will definitely break out on November the 4th.
Are you concerned that those who served in the Trump administration, but at the same time perhaps have a similar foreign policy and national security outlook that you do, will somehow be forced to, you know, either pick a side in this inevitable fight within the Republican Party?
Well, that's part of the problem with Trump is that he has torqued around the whole country, but particularly the Republican Party. You're either for Trump or against Trump. To me, the point of getting involved in politics is philosophy. It wasn't loyalty to one person that moved me to get involved in 1964 with Barry Goldwater, and I think most other people. Of course, we admire people like Goldwater and Reagan, but we also disagree with them when our views tell us that they've taken a wrong tack. That's the debate we've got to have. Whether Trump was in favor of it or not, frankly, I hope will become pretty irrelevant in just a short period of time. The issue is, what's best for America? Is it consistent with our philosophy?
But you don't really expect, even if Trump were to lose, or after 2024, should he win, him to leave the stage. He will be a powerful voice, and his family will continue to be a powerful voice in Republican politics.
Well, let me take issue with that, because I'm not sure. I think especially if he loses, I think people are tired of him. I think very few people are willing to say it publicly. I mean, obviously, at this point, I have nothing to lose in that sense. And I understand why there are many who don't want to speak up publicly. But I would not discount the impact, once he's gone, of people saying, thank God that's over with.
So that may be the case within the Beltway and the people carrying out policy, elected officials. But let's talk about the country more broadly. One of the things that's unique about what you've done when you're out of government was not only going on Fox News and writing quite regularly, but also involved in the politics of this all, right? You had a PAC, Super PAC, for example. President Trump has a very loyal base. You can debate how large that base is, 35% of Americans, up to 45% of Americans. I mean, they are not looking back here. Do you think those supporters want anything else other than MAGA to continue?
Yes, very definitely. Look, I think they're loyal to Trump because of who he's opposed to and who's opposed to him. And it's a pretty unsavory cast of characters on the other side. I don't have any doubt about that. You know, I haven't suddenly become a squishy liberal here. I'm just the same conservative I was the day I started in the Trump administration. And I think the message is, it's okay to be a conservative and anti-Trump. And I think out in the country, even more than inside the Beltway, people don't like many of the personal attributes. And I think they listen to people who say he's actually got a conservative philosophy. A conservative could not have said during the coronavirus struggle, president has all the power, I'll just tell the governors what to do. Could not have said it. And once we break the spell of the incumbency, I think this is going to dissipate fairly quickly.
Before we get to our lightning round, knowing that we have to wrap up this discussion, tell us a little bit about what you're doing. Obviously, you left the administration. You wrote this 500-page book that probably was all-consuming. Now you're going out speaking about it. But in terms of your involvement, your public profile, actually doing some of the things you've just described, do you have any kind of specific plans to advance the agenda you just articulated?
Well, I expect to be doing a lot of the same things I did before joining the administration and doing personal private business as well. But my priority from now until the foreseeable future is this battle for the soul of conservatism and the Republican Party. I think this is critical. I think we have moved away from Reagan's guidance during the Trump administration. I think it's very, very important to get it back on track.
So let's end this discussion with our lightning round. Ambassador Bolton, give us your favorite Reagan quote, book, or speech, all three or any one of them.
Well, I think the best, my favorite speech is the speech at the Berlin Wall. There's just no question about it. Reagan defied the wishes of the State Department speechwriters and said, Mr. Gorbachev, open this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. And it's really a bookend when you go back to John Kennedy's speech at the Berlin Wall in 1963, where he said, people say there's no real difference between communism and the West, and there's no challenge and so on. Let them come to Berlin, he said. And then, of course, famously said, I'm a Berliner. So I think the Kennedy-Reagan speeches at Berlin are just two of the best of the Cold War. And it just shows Ronald Reagan at his best, right there saying, come and tear this wall down. My favorite quote, though, of Reagan is on a similar line, and it's one of those ones that his critics say is so simplistic and so on. Shows to me his real genius when he was saying to some of his advisors about how does the Cold War end? How is this supposed to work out? And he said it works out this way: we win, they lose.
We'll leave it there, Ambassador Bolton. Thank you so much for joining us. Look forward to having you back on the show in the not too distant future.
Well, thanks again for having me. Look forward to it.